And by God's grace, I'm going to continue with you for a different model, the Inland Waterway Transport. That's the full title of the model. So as we can see, the title is an Inland Waterway Transport. But pick one, we detach the full title into two. We'll leave the transport aside and ask ourselves, what is an inland waterway? In this context, you might quickly draw a conclusion that any water body can be an inland waterway. Yes, I agree. But we are going to look at that water body from the perspective of the free forwarder or any other stakeholder in shipping going to use the inland waterway as source of commerce, to use it to trade, to work, and get money. That is the perspective from which we are going to look at it. That's why if you see, we did a sea container as a unit of transport, we are going to do maritime transport, we are going to do air transport, we are going to do road transport, rail transport, and what have you. So we are going to look at a water body as a means of transport. So in effect, I'll ask you, what is an inland waterway? And as the book writers from the slide, you can see it's a stream or a body of water that can be used for commercial transportation. Commercial. So if even the water body is so exhaustive, so exotic, and you cannot navigate it for commercial purposes, to the freight forwarder, it's of no benefit. So any water body that can be navigated or transported upon for commercial purposes, the freight forwarders and other users of that water term it an inland waterway and used for navigation. That's why the full title of the model or the course is Inland Waterway Transport. But then, the fact that you can navigate on the water body for commercial purposes, that water body should be suitable. So you're going to look at the features of the water body that can qualify as an inland waterway, just like we did for the sea container. You know, any box can be termed as a steel box, and for that matter, can be loaded in, packed out, and transported. But then we went further to see that there are features that qualifies a particular container made up of certain materials to be called a sea container or a box we use for the maritime transportation. So here, let's quickly look at examples of the water bodies, either natural, artificial. Yeah, there are two types of way we this water body says it's either natural or by man-made, artificial. So we have rivers, we have lakes, but in when it comes to lakes, we have both natural and artificial lakes. But when you come to canals, canals are normally man-made, artificial. Yes, lagoons are there, and what have you. These are navigable, and for it to be navigable to serve the purpose of commercialization, it should be that water body should be deep, wide, slow enough for a vessel to pass, and there should be no obstacles or obstructions in the water body like rocks, trees, low bridges, tree stumps, icebergs, fogs, frost. If these obstructions are in the water body, it does not qualify to be navigated. And even then, let me zero down on the low bridges. So the low bridges are a feature, very popular bridges are features in the advanced countries, as you know. So those low bridges are collapsible bridges. So anytime a vessel wants to navigate on that water body, the bridge is open apart, the vessel passes, then they close it up for vehicular usage. So that is about these bridges, low bridges example you see as an obstacle. Yeah. Then there comes what factors enhances or affects the navigability of a waterway. The depth of water should be deep enough to carry the draft of the vessel. Tides conditions, that is the low and high tides, very important and critical. And even the size of the vessel going to apply on the water body is also another factor. Then the speed of water. A very high water speed may also make a channel unnavigable. The width of the inland waterway, yeah, high altitude. Then we have floating, ice, storms, fog, etc. These things, if they don't exist, they make the water body more navigable. Then the depth of water has been picked among the lot that we just saw in the previous slide and described into details. That tells you the master, the hallmark of all the other factors is the depth of water, the deepness. Shallow waters cannot be navigated upon for any commercial purpose. So the depth of the water slide, if you read it thoroughly, there's nothing there that needs any deeper explanation like it is there. It is self-explanatory. Then we have the tides condition, the tide low or high tide. Yes, the tides are also very critical, especially when the water body is artificially made, and with the tide conditions are very prevalent and very noticeable and very frequent and really occurs when canals are dug to draw water from their natural source. So the Suez Canal, the Panama Canal, and there's a seaport in Iraq called the Port of Yunkasa. They dug the canal, and for instance, if you go to Iraq, the Port of Yunkasa is a canal, and they draw the seawater from the Gulf Sea. And so it is, if you come to the Suez, they also use the Mediterranean Sea, and the Panama in the Americans also use it. So anytime the source of the water also dries up or lowers, it draws the water back into its source, and the vessels are left grounded or stuck until enough water comes in before navigation can be possible. So the tide conditions, the depth of the water conditions are very two critical things that you should know about what qualifies the water body to be navigable, and for that matter, for commercial purposes. Yes. Floating ice are not prevalent in this part of the world. We don't see it here because we don't have that weather called winter. But if you really go to the arid countries, the winter prone countries, you see floating ice a lot. Most water bodies get frozen and turn into ice, so that even temporarily or momentarily navigation through those sort of channels or mediums are suspended mandatorily. Even certain portions of the sea can get frozen with severe winter low, very severe winter low temperatures. So floating ice do occur. And fogs and icebergs also come in way of navigating vessels. Yes. So the next question we'll ask is, how can inland water be made navigable? All the question is, they are already navigable. How can we enhance the navigability and make it more navigable? Okay. Yeah. One, by dredging. Mechanical means installation of locks that increase and register water depth. Yes, construction of floodgates. Dredging, we'll look at the pictures in the next slides. It's a question of sanction. Yeah, you distill, you collect the silts or sand or certain sediment from the bottom of any water body to make it deeper, and then you discard those silts or debris collected into a different place altogether. So we have dredges, then we have a dredge, we have dredger, and then we have the process is the dredging, which we'll look at very soon. The pictures are self-explanatory. It was this dredging method that the owners and the builders of MPS, that's Terminal 3, used to claim that vast land from the sea, that size of land for the ashore infrastructure. Yes, we moved deeper into the sea and created the breakwater and other, infrastructures and superstructures. Yes. Dredging is a very important method that we use to make waterway more navigable. Installation of locks. These locks are of more of European concept. It's not popular in the world like dredging. Dredging is across the globe. And then construction of floodgates too is also across the globe. But lock mechanism or lock installations are of European origin or European taste than the rest of the world. So here we go. Dredging is an excavation activity, I've explained. Then the dredge is the device. Then the dredger is the vessel that the dredge is installed on to come into the sea and do the dredging. And the type of dredging vessels are listed there for your consumption. We go further, and these are the picture of various type of dredge. The dredges and the dredges equipments or devices of them, and the work they do is dredging. Yes, and your seniors were lucky. They went and visited the MPS or Terminal 3 throughout their construction stage. So they really saw dredges, and what dredging involves physically and lively by themselves. But this is your time. MPS is finished and is operating at full capacity as a modern container terminal. So you do have the opportunity to see a dredge, a practical one. The use of locks, as I've explained, this locks business is of more of a European orientation and methodology than the rest of the globe. Yeah, so these are types of locks. Yes, you see this one. There's another type of lock, The floodgates are just example, like the floodgates that you see built on dams, so that when the dam is flooded, if they don't open that floodgate for the excess water to flow, that same water pressure will destroy and break or crash the dam. So if you see the pictures very soon, and you see that it's no other technology or acts that what you see. Maybe if you have visited the Akosombo dam, the case that you see that they release excess water is what we call the floodgates. Yes. And there are different types that are listed there, and the pictures shows them, the types that are listed with their pictures accompanying them. Yeah, geography of inland waterways. Yes, with me, I normally deal with my country examples or inland waterway geography. Then I get out of Ghana, deal with Africa situation before I veer into the rest of the world, and especially Europe and America, where the inland waterway transportation is very developed and extensively used for their economic benefits. Yes, remember, navigability of a water for commercial purposes makes that water body an inland waterway. So they are well developed. So the examples here are, apart from the Volta Lake and the Volta River, are all European examples. So we skip the first three, the zero, and dwell on the Volta Lake and the Volta River more. After that, we look at other rivers, possibly in Africa. Then we veer into the European and American worlds.